Hi guys, welcome to another evening chat with Bodhi Room. My name is Nakul. I'm just going to paste the comment. Hopefully, yeah, we can just pin this over here so it'll be helpful for people who are joining. Excellent. So we are live. My name is Nakul, like I said. It's an evening chat with Bodhi Room. Just waiting for our guest to join, but before that, we've got an interesting chat today with a startup founder. And it's not just any startup, it's it's something that's really cool, something that's really different from the normal. So it's all about relationships, it's all about finding the right partner. So we're going to be hearing a really cool perspective on that. If you are watching this later, which you would be, and you have any questions, you can just comment in the IGTV video and we'll get to it. We'll be speaking with Priyanka of Marriage Broker Auntie, who I think has joined. So I'm just going to invite her to share my screen. Just waiting for Priyanka to join. Hi Priyanka, how are you?
Hey, hi, Nakul. I'm doing good. How are you?
Very well, thanks. I was just introducing people. Can you see me and hear me properly?
Yes, I can. What about you?
Okay, excellent. Yes, everything's clear. Everything's perfect, which is not always the case, unfortunately. Airtel is my connection and it doesn't always work out well.
Right, but today's perfect.
And Priyanka, is it cloudy where you are as well?
We spoke too soon.
We spoke too soon. Oh my God, I jinxed it. Can you hear me now?
Yes, I can.
Okay. I was just asking, is it cloudy where you are as well?
Yeah, it's very cloudy.
I always get excited when monsoon is around the corner. So this is a nice time to nice time to be having a chat with you. Priyanka, very nice to have you here. I'm looking forward to this chat. I was telling people for the sake of the IGTV video later that, you know, it's a very interesting startup that you've conceptualized and you're working on, very different from the typical sort of corporate to startup journey. Maybe we can kick it off. Maybe we can start with a quick introduction about yourself.
Sure. Yeah. So I'm Priyanka Bhardwaj. I'm based in Bangalore. I'm also from here. I have a bachelor's in engineering and a master's in business administration. In a previous life, I used to be a senior product manager with Amazon in London. Now I run Marriage Broker Auntie, which is a matrimonial advisory and a relationship coaching service.
Right. And what does that mean? So what is matrimonial advisory and relationship coaching? I'm assuming, I am not very familiar with this field, but I'm assuming it's new, not just in India, but abroad as well.
I'd like to believe I kind of made it up, but so what we do is we help people navigate partner search by providing advisory and coaching services. So essentially anyone who, you know, wants to look for a partner and obviously is not in love already or dating somebody has to go through the arranged marriage route or arranged dating, right, whatever you call it, right? We act as a sounding board, a mentorship, or a coach to help them successfully navigate that journey in one piece.
Okay, interesting. Is there a it's a new concept for me. I've not heard of something like this before. As you said, you've come up with it yourself. Yeah. You've been. Is there a analog in some other field which you can sort of compare it to, which would give an idea about how it works?
So, I mean, I think to think of a very simple example, it's like going to a gym and hiring a personal trainer to achieve a certain goal, right?
Okay.
Anyone who is looking for a partner is already on various apps and, you know, portals, etc. Could be doing a variety of things, but may not really be making progress in that journey, right?
Right.
Swiping 50 times a day or going on one date a month, you know, you don't know if that's really progress, if you're getting closer to your goal of finding a partner. So
that's true.
The approach that we take is we help you make a complete assessment of yourself, what you're looking for, what your aspirations are, and then assessing every step of the way whether you're moving in the right direction. And we kind of be that, like a coach. We act as a coach where we are constantly helping you introspect, following up on your progress, trying to ensure that you get to where you want to get.
Got it.
Yeah.
So the best way to think about it is like a personal trainer for your relationships, your personal side. So
exactly.
You might take
exactly.
care of your physical side in a gym. This, managed broker auntie is where you take care of your personal relationships.
Exactly. Exactly.
Now coming to the name, managed broker auntie, it's very, very catchy. It's something that stuck in my head immediately. How and where did this name come up from? How and where did the organization or the idea about the startup come up from?
Sure. Yeah, it just felt like a very funny name to begin with.
Yeah.
So I thought, okay, I'll, have this name. So back in 2012 or 2013, when I started doing this, I wanted a name for my Facebook page because I decided to do it on Facebook. I helped set up a few friends of mine and they ended up getting married. And I wanted to do more of it. And I said, okay, chalo, let me make a Facebook page to see if I can attract more people in my extended network.
Yeah.
So I was thinking, what do I name the page? And Marriage Broker Auntie represented that quintessential auntie who's there in every family, who's like looking out, who's like, trying to check if all the single people are married, bringing rishtas and things like that. I just came up with that name and that's just stuck on. Although, we pivoted into advisory and things like that along the way, that name just stuck on. And I feel like it's one of those things that needs to get changed at some point when it becomes too corporate. But for now, it'll stay.
No, I think, and I mentioned this over WhatsApp as well, the first thing that came to my mind, and I was sort of researching your organization as well. I know you featured in a news article along with the infamous marriage, the real life Netflix auntie. So there's no connection, I assume, with that lady and with that show.
No, nothing at all.
Okay, understood. But, the name is very nice and I'm sure it'll catch on as well. What I wanted to also deep dive, because you've been doing this for a while, like you said, even before you formally set it up, you had already been matchmaking for your friends. Based on your observations of the people and your clients, what do you think are the things that people are looking for in relationships or in partners, specifically our generation or, the modern generation?
Yeah, I think our generation is a bit of a transition generation. I like to think of it as we are the generation that wants to embrace polyamory while being unable to let go of monogamy. Because we understand that, you can't get everything all the time from your partner because, we have access to information and, like we know much more about relationships and marriages than the previous generation. But I think we want to get as close to it as possible, where we can get everything from one person, even though, we know we can't get it. I think we're very, very self-aware. We have access to a lot of
That's
information,
right.
unlike the previous generation who were more like, shadi karni hai, bas shadi karni hai. We're not like that. We're very deliberate, intentional about the decision. And I feel like we're fairly independent by the time we make this decision. We've tested our personality that is, pretty well formed by this age through relationships, living in with flatmates, etc. So I think our requirements are very nuanced, unlike the previous generation.
Correct.
So if I were to say, if there's one thing that I've seen that is most common in this generation is people who want relationships which are as much about a relationship as it is about their independence.
Okay.
I feel like that summarizes what I see in this generation, right? People want to be married, but they don't want to lose their independence. And I feel like that's the number one thing most people ask for nowadays, at least, based on my observation.
And is it an impossible situation? I mean, what is the advice that you, obviously it's, it would be case by case,
But do you think that duality of wanting to be wanting marriage and wanting sort of, I assume wanting a stable marriage the way we've maybe seen our parents or our parents' generation, but at the same time wanting to retain the independence that we've seen, is that possible or is that something that's an impossible expectation?
Yeah, I mean, it is what you want and it is what you should
Okay.
strive towards. It's not impossible, right?
Okay.
If that's what you want, you can go get
Yeah.
it. But then I think where I kind of try to get people to focus on is understanding that it's a journey. It's
Yeah.
not like day one after you get married, you'll be like, chalo, 8 to 9 is your time and like 9 to 10 is our time. It's not going to be that straightforward.
Yeah.
So I guess I help people understand that it's a journey. But
Right.
if that's what you want, that's what you want, right? Like, who am I to go and say you're not going to get it?
Yeah. Okay. One thing that you'd mentioned earlier as well is, there's a lot of apps around. And it's not just the dating apps like Tinder, Hinge, Bumble. It's also, the traditional sort of arranged marriage things have moved into apps,
Matrimonial
I
apps,
assume. Yeah, matrimonial apps. So how is that, in your view, affecting the way people are looking at relationships or the even further the way they're looking at marriages?
I think these apps, dating apps as well as matrimonial apps, are great in the sense that they act as social discovery platforms, right? You get access to
Yeah.
people that you never had before, which is great, and technology enables that. But I think they've also just the experience of being on these apps has brought in a whole new set of problems that never existed before. You
Okay.
know, ghosting, gaslighting,
Yeah.
daily like rejections, breadcrumbing, and whatnot, right? Like
Yeah.
I can't keep up with the terminology, but there is so much that never existed before. And I think that makes the whole experience a little bit unpleasant. Like, and it
Yeah.
also helps you build a lot of resilience, which is a good thing in a way. Like, if you're getting rejected so many times every day, that's good in a way, but it's also sad
Yeah.
because you kind of build a wall around yourself. You don't want to be
Right.
vulnerable. You end up coming
Yeah.
across as defensive. You're not open to getting to know somebody. And
That's true.
the experience is so different from, back in the past where you'd meet just a handful of people and, you make a decision within that. This whole
Yeah.
illusion of infinite choice has a risk of making some people jaded. May not be
Yeah.
everybody.
Absolutely.
But depending on, your own sort of personality, what you're looking for, etc., you can have a varied experience and may not always be pleasant.
Yeah, absolutely. I was thinking about this a little earlier as well. So what you said, we're on the cusp of, the old ways of doing relationships and the new ways, which the new ways, I don't know if you agree, we can simplify to the Western way of sort of dating and then figuring out if the person's right for you. We weren't necessarily equipped to go about dating the way in the 90s, up till the 90s, the Western world went about, going to a bar and just asking for somebody's number who you like. I don't think Indians in general are that assertive or have taught, have been taught to be that assertive.
Probably not. We're probably better off
Yeah.
writing scripts that will swipe 50 times a day and
Exactly. That's what I thought. So,
bots that will
yeah.
talk to people and stuff, right?
Yeah. So that's what I thought from the app perspective. For a lot of people in India, perhaps it was a, it's eased the way into dating. Because without it, how do you just go and talk to somebody in a bar or a restaurant or something? It's not something that's done. If our parents don't know how to do it, then how are we going to learn how to do it, right? But yeah, I get what you're
Absolutely.
saying. It's, do you think that things like Tinder, where it's swipe left, swipe right, based on, and I was talking about this to some people today about how Instagram is just about the image, right? Nobody's going to read the caption really, they're just going to see the image. Do you think that's an effect that happens, and people do talk about it, but do you feel that that's something that happens on dating
That does happen, right? Like, because the experience itself is designed like that. Like, your entire
apps?
screen is just the picture, and there's
Yeah.
just a name and age or like something like that.
Yeah. Yeah.
So you don't, what are you evaluating people on? Just the vibe or the face or like whatever.
Yeah.
So I have this thing where I say, right, where like, if someone looks good, if someone looks good, then the picture is enough. You don't have to write shit in the bio or like whatever, right?
Yeah.
But if you're super ugly, then again, like, you're out. But
Yeah.
if you're borderline, somewhere in the middle,
Yeah.
you are
Yeah.
forced to write good stuff in your bio.
That's right.
Like, because That's the only like bailout that you have, right? So I think given that, you know, probably looks follow and follows a normal distribution, majority of the people are average looking. So I think to a large extent, you know, people do try
it
to
does
like
matter.
Read. Yeah, it does matter
read
to an
about
extent.
it.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's an interesting way of looking at it. I never applied normal distribution to the dating sort of aspect of it. It's almost strategic in the way, you know,
yeah.
to think about whether you need to put a caption or, you know, you need to actually bother writing something interesting.
Yeah.
Very interesting
Yeah.
way of looking at it.
Yeah. And I think it's very important to make sure that, you know, there's a fine line of sounding cool and trying too hard. It's about striking that fine line. Yeah. So there is some thought.
I'm sure you advise your clients about how to even present themselves on dating apps. Do you, you know, do you, that old trope about being yourself and being genuine, is that something you advise people? Because if your genuine thing is that I spend, you know, 2 hours after work every day on Netflix because I'm too tired and exhausted to do anything else, but it may not sound particularly nice on an app. Is that something you would recommend to people?
Yeah, I mean, I would never recommend that they be anyone else but themselves, right? Because finding a partner is just one part of it. Bloody, you have to live with them for the rest of your life. If you're pretending to be someone else, then you're screwed, right?
Yeah.
So it's fine. I mean, there is somebody who will appreciate that you lie like a potato in front of the TV for 2 hours, right? You never know.
And
so,
that's the right person for you.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
Okay, fair enough. We were talking earlier about, you know, whether it's possible to, you know, have your independence and have a stable marriage or relationship as well. And sort of, it's just about, you know, calming your expectations about how quickly that will happen. Are there other things like that where you commonly see in your clients, which you think are misconceptions or getting in the way of them having a stable relationship? Are there certain commonalities across all your clients where they have those misconceptions?
I wouldn't call them misconceptions. I think nowadays it's more likely to find people who carry a lot of baggage from either childhood or relationships because unlike the previous generation, we obviously have had opportunities to be in relationships, you know, like unlike our parents or whatever. We've been in multiple relationships by the time we marry somebody. The other thing is, we're also a generation with fewer children for our parents. So our parents' attention was all out on us, right? So there are a lot of people who have some sort of childhood like trauma or like any like, you know, mini sort of experience that they carry with them.
Yeah.
That trickles into the relationship, right?
Right.
Being aware of that and being open to the fact that it's going to take a while to, you know, find this comfortable space where both of you can grow together is important. That patience and to wait it out and to give each other space and to be able to talk through that is important.
Yeah.
And I feel like that is something people haven't probably internalized. But that is something you have to be more intentional about today.
Okay.
Especially in this generation.
Okay. What role in that case, and again, this goes to, maybe it's more of an Indian thing. You know, I definitely in my case also, you know, sometimes we feel that relationships are a very private thing and not even family, you want to talk to them about it. You only find out later that there were problems and all.
Yeah.
So in that kind of a situation, what role would a, you know, maybe a trusted friend or in your case, or in marriage broker auntie's case, a relationship coach, what role can that play? How should a person wanting advice on relationships approach sort of you and the idea of marriage broker auntie being an advisor? How would that work?
So, you know, this is, I'm you know, when you ask me this question, I'm reminded of like, you know, like just generally jobs in tech, right? Like within tech, a quality that is appreciated a lot is being able to be very hands-on and independent and do your thing, but also ask for help at the right time to be able to move forward, to be able to grow, right? I think that is a super important quality even in your personal life, right? to handle your matters independently, to have that privacy, to have that boundary around the couple, saying, you know, this is our thing, we'll work it out. But also to quickly realize and say, okay, something's not working, we need help, right? Whether that's a family member, a trusted friend, or, you know, a therapist or a counselor or even a coach, you have to recognize that quickly and act on it, because there will be a point of no return at some point, right? You don't want to wait till that point to actually make amends. In a relationship, I think it's very important to have two individuals who are equally committed to making that relationship work. And when you have that, you will find a way to get help. And what a coach or a therapist or anybody, right, external professional who can support you will do is they provide you a safe space of no judgment or any bias. And the focus is on you. If you go to a friend or a family member, well, depends, right? They can either patronize you or there's a baggage of reciprocity. You know, if they listen to your woes, next you have to listen to me. You don't have any such pressures when you're paying a professional to help you with something, right? The professional's focused on giving you the best value for what you've come to them for. And this is something people are not aware of or not used to, because as you said, right, like it's a private matter, and going to somebody else seems like an admission of failure. But here's the thing, right? Admission of failure and saying that this is just a fail in, like, you know, one moment of my life, in one little part of my life, and trying to fix that is a first step. It's a virtue of a winner, right? It's a virtue of someone who can actually grow and get better. So I think realizing that point where you say, actually, let me get help and be much better off is important.
Yeah. I mean, that's an interesting point you just mentioned as well. The fact that, you know, going for something like this to people that in your life, and not just about the fact that you'll have to reciprocate, maybe you don't necessarily want to get into that, but also sometimes people do, even if they mean well for us in general, maybe they do carry some biases or, you know, certain insecurities of their own, and which might filter into the advice that they give you. In this case, another way of looking at it is like any other service, where it's in the, you know, professional's best interest to provide you the best advice for your sake, because that just enhances their reputation.
Yeah,
that's a very interesting way of looking at it. I wanted to ask a tough question. Before I move on to the next one, actually, I'll just ask you this. So you just mentioned about therapists and how it's important for them, for all sorts of professionals in this space, to provide a safe space.
Yeah.
For a layperson like myself, what would be the difference between, say, what marriage broker auntie does and, you know, what couples counseling is? What is the differences?
Yeah, that's a great question. So therapy tends to focus a lot on your past and analyzing, you know, what has happened in your past and, you know, trying to draw patterns out there to explain why you may be behaving the way you are. Right. It is a very, very, very long drawn out process before you can get to any actionable insight that you start modifying that behavior or changing that behavior. Yeah. Changing that behavior may not always be possible, depending on whether it's a inherent disability or a illness. So depending on that, like, you know, like whether you change that or not, you know, depends on that. Coaching, on the other hand, focuses a lot on the present and the future in terms of what you want to achieve. And it tends to be very, very goal focused, which is why what I do is very specifically around, you want to find a partner, we will work towards that. That's a very, very specific goal, right?
Yeah.
So we may go into a little bit of your past to help build awareness around how you make your choices, how you make your decisions, but we don't harbor on that. I don't ever say, okay, oh shit, okay, you know, you can't find a partner. Like, we've studied your entire history, it's over. Like, it's not like that, but therapy sometimes can be like that, right? So we try to find that balance and we alternate. Sometimes it's sharing insights about the market where someone will come and say, okay, what I'm doing, is that right? Does this work? Sometimes it's just someone venting out and you just listen. So we alternate between being a mentor, being a coach, being an advisor. Yeah. And a coach is someone who's keeping you focused on the goal. So that's essentially what it is.
Okay. So one is, so couples counseling would be reactive and relationship coaching would be proactive, right?
Yeah,
Is
and therapy
probably.
also tends to be like, you know, you're very, very like, if I were to take an example of a single person, like I do get people sometimes who are very, very, who've just come out of a bad relationship, but they're in very
Yeah.
early stages of it, and sometimes they're also feeling very suicidal. I'm not equipped to
Yeah.
handle that because I'm not a
Yeah. Yeah.
therapist, right? In
Right.
which case, I make a recommendation that they go to a therapist, right?
Okay.
I only work with healthy individuals who are very clear, saying, okay, this is my goal, this is where I want to get. Can you please help me get there?
So there may be baggage, but you wouldn't necessarily get involved when the baggage is a priority. In that case, you
Yeah.
might recommend. Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Got it.
Yeah.
Okay, so tough question I was going to come to, and this is based on some conversations I've been having with people and
Sure.
hearing about things.
Sure.
What I've been hearing, of course, is that while the sort of dating and the casual sort of relationship aspect is going on, guys can be very open and sort of honest and everything. When it starts coming time to, talking about marriage, etc., the chauvinism, that's when it emerges. Is that something you see is the bad behavior or sort of the hypocritical behavior still prevalent or more amongst the men? Is that something that you observe in the conversations with clients?
What do you mean by like chauvinism prevails when they have to
In the
make
sense
a
that,
like a decision?
right, when the decision comes, then it's about, well, I wanted my family needs a wife like this, and this is what,
Oh, okay.
this is the kind of wife that I want. So everything else before it goes out of the window. And it's more about, okay, this is no, but you should have known that this is what I wanted. Is that something that you observe, or is that not very prevalent?
Right. No, actually, I'm not sure I can agree with that because
Okay.
I think I do hear a lot of people who are on dating apps who meet very interesting men, and this is women who come, like more often women come and tell me that, you know, I met this really interesting guy, but he's not willing to commit. And I don't want to bother convincing him that he needs to get married. I think it's not because the girl is not right. It's not because they want a different kind of girl or that, you know, they want to please their parents. It's just they're not ready for it. And that's why they're on a dating app and not on a matrimonial app. And I think it's about
Right.
recognizing that and saying, actually, this person is not ready to commit. It's not me, right?
Yeah.
It's not me that he or she, I mean, he has a problem with. It's just that this person is not ready. And I
Right.
find that for guys nowadays, they do, at least the more like educated, savvy, exposed men tend to steer clear from matrimonial apps and they prefer to be on dating apps because they don't like that pressure. They don't like that pressure of having to decide very quickly. They
Yeah.
want to, you know, see what all they can get, right? They're open to that
Right.
whole range of possibilities.
Yeah.
So I think that's the case. I wouldn't say it's chauvinism necessarily.
Okay. Yeah.
Because I've heard both sides of the stories where guys
Okay.
feel like, oh my God, like women are too feminist, or like where
Yeah.
women feel like, oh, guys are like haven't grown up and things like that.
Yeah.
So
Yeah.
I don't think I can agree with that view like fully.
Okay. That's a unique perspective to have to stand in the middle of both and see sort
Yeah,
of
yeah.
what one is saying about the other.
Yeah, no, I mean, which is why I feel like, you know, it's easier for me to have a more balanced approach because sometimes when I have a weekly newsletter that I write. When I
Yeah.
write supporting women, I see a
Yeah.
lot of men who get angry and come back to me. And then
Yeah. Not
after a
all
week,
men,
I'll
right?
have, yeah, not all men. And after a week, if I write one, you know, for the other gender attacks you. And then it's like, guys, I'm a neutral participant. Like, you know, I have no business taking sides. But because I get to see equal number of men and women, I think somewhere my perspective today is balanced.
Yeah, but perhaps that's also because I think the space for centrism has disappeared in everything. It's
Yeah,
just you're either us or against us. We got
exactly.
an interesting question, and I guess this is about the differences in matrimonial apps versus dating apps. Do you
Yeah.
think people tend to be more open, and I guess Anjali means more open with the person they're talking to or chatting with on a dating app versus if they were chatting with someone on a matrimonial app?
Yeah, for sure, no, because you don't have a lot of information on a dating app
Yeah.
that influences you. I'll give
Right.
you an example. This is something I am guilty of doing, okay? I don't believe or like care about any of this stuff, but I am guilty of
Yeah.
doing this. On a matrimonial app, sometimes you have a lot of information about somebody, right?
Yeah.
They'll say that, you know, they're middle class or lower middle class. They'll say that they have five or six siblings, and then suddenly you're like, whoa, shit, maybe all that matters. But if you want to meet this person on a dating app, you don't have that information. So you don't make any sort of judgments about who they are, where they come from or anything, right? So I think definitely people are more open. But also I'm seeing of late that these apps are also trying to introduce a few filters to improve the level of intent on these apps.
Yeah.
And I'm afraid that they're moving closer to matrimonial apps these days. Okay. Yeah. Your caste, your political views and like whatnot, right? Like, so,
Interesting. Okay.
Yeah.
No, that's really interesting. And it's cool that, you know, it's still cool that it's the dating apps that have pushed the app model, and then the matrimonials have been like, okay, we can do that as well. Okay, so we've got something that's, I think, more relationship-oriented. Mayuri asks, how do we confront the situation where the guy says, why are you talking about marriage, when they have met on a dating app? So I think you briefly mentioned this. Maybe she's joined a bit late. But if you can address that.
I think people are on a dating app because they don't want to necessarily get married. Because if they wanted to get married, then they would be on a Shaadi.com or a Bharat Matrimony, right? They want to just date. They want to just kind of, you know, be casual and see what comes off it. They want to keep it quite open. So I think when people talk about marriage, it just throws them off a little bit. And I think I do hear this problem a lot from women, actually. They come and say, you know, guys on dating apps are so much better than the guys on the matrimonial apps, but they don't want to get married. You know, too bad. Right?
Do you think it's a difference in perspective of, you know, where women in India might treat dating apps as a, you know, or may treat relationships or dating as a pathway to marriage, whereas guys are just sort of playing the field to see sort of just as a another component of their life, not necessarily leading to anything? Do you think that difference is there?
At least based on my experience, I've seen that a lot more women think of marriage as a thing that they need to do. Thing that is on the path to, let's say, having children or having a complete life or like whatever, right? Less men feel that pressure. And men are like, hey, there's this new toy. Let me go check it out and see what comes off it, right? So women are much more intentional about who they want to spend the rest of their life with, their, you know, because they're going to bear their children, and life changes so much more for women compared to men. I mean, it changes for men as well, but, you know, a lot more for women. So they're a little bit more intentional, unlike men, I think.
Okay. That makes sense. And I guess women are, I mean, not just from societal pressure, but also biologically, they feel that they're on a clock. So maybe they have to hurry things up. Whereas men either don't get that pressure. Or I don't know if the biology exists for men as well, or maybe they just don't get that pressure from society.
Yeah, it does. I think men also have that. It's just that it's a lot later.
It's not talked about.
Yeah, it's not talked about. It's a lot later. Women have this 30 number hanging around their head. Yeah. And so there is obviously a lot more pressure for women, I think.
Yeah, makes sense. Okay, we've talked a lot, and, you know, I want to move on to sort of if somebody is looking to, you know, take the help of Manage Broker Auntie, how does that work? So what are the steps that, now, how does that actually, the process work?
Yeah, so currently I offer a 3-month coaching program and it's called the Marriage Material. So basically, when you sign up, you get access to a personal coach, which is me, who will work with you for a period of 3 months. We'll have regular sessions where we'll talk more about what your relationship values are and, you know, how, what your aspirations are and how do you actually bring those into conversations with people, and that way, how can you actually make your search more effective and things like that. But we also understand that people are on different points in this journey. So depending on where you are in that journey, we customize that program for you. We're available for support constantly. Apart from, you know, providing advice, I do a lot of events. So people also get access to those events, like, you know, blind dating events and things like that. So they could potentially even, you know, get to meet somebody by working with me. So,
interesting.
Yeah.
Oh, that's it. Very interesting. We got a question from Mayuri again. I don't think it's in your field of sort of what you do, but I'm going to ask it anyway because it'll help clarify what Managed Broker Auntie does. So Mayuri asks, how soon should we speak about Kundli? I have seen many guys who speak for 2 3 weeks, then say our Kundli isn't matching. So is this something that
Yeah.
you talk about in your work? And what if yes, what are your thoughts on it?
Yeah, so I'm not a big proponent of Kundli matching at all. I think already it is quite difficult to find a suitable partner. If you add Kundli to the mix, that's not going to help you much. So I like people to take a very clear stance right in the beginning. If they say, yes, you know, I cannot marry somebody without a Kundli, fine. That's your thing and you have to work with that. But if someone's on the fence, then I encourage and somehow try to convince them that, you know, they should ditch that and actually strongly stand by that saying, I'm against Kundli. I don't care about it. And if the opposite party remotely cares about it, this is not going to work. And I'm not even going to waste my time talking to you, right? So I think being very upfront about that is very important. And I know a lot of people who use Kundli isn't matching as a proxy for, you know, I don't want to continue this. This is a very polite way to say no without
It's
hurting
an easy
anyone's
out.
feelings. Yeah, exactly. Right? Because not many people understand how the Kundli matching works. Right? And also, I think the problem with Kundli matching is all of these apps, some of them give you like a score of your Kundli matches. Right? The thing is, out of 36 points of all like the 8 different criteria that the Kundli matching does, you need to get like above 18. You need to get 50%. 50% is a passing mark. But if you see someone's, you've got 19 with somebody and 21 with someone else, you'll pick the 21 fellow. Doesn't matter what aspect of your Kundli matching was lower or higher, right? So people don't understand it and you make random judgments based on this information. So I would say be upfront. If you don't care about Kundli, say, do you don't care about Kundli? And right, that way you save yourself some heartburn.
Makes sense. Mayuri, probably not exactly what you wanted to hear, but maybe it could be that the guys are taking an easy out, or maybe they're just sort of really convinced that Kundlis are the only way. So I guess that would come down to you.
Yeah.
How do you feel about it, and are you sort of how are
Yeah.
you treating
Yeah, for
it?
sure.
All right, perfect. This has been a great conversation, Priyanka. I wanted to ask you, is there anything, obviously your course, your 3 month course, as a regular feature, but is there anything particularly new features, new products, new launches that are coming up for Managed Broker Auntie that you can talk about?
Yeah, sure. I mean, not really new launches, but if someone wants to get a feel for what it's like to work with us, so I have two free courses that I offer. It's like a self-paced course. One is called Self-Love, and this has been designed in the context of dating and finding a partner, because I think a lot of times you go through this journey and you think, oh my God, what's wrong with me? Like, why am I getting so many rejections? I think it's important to realize that it's not you. And so this course is about finding that resilience and saying, I am awesome the way I am, and I need to find someone who appreciates this awesomeness. The second course is called Arrange Your Own Marriage. It takes you through the process of finding a partner on all of these apps and portals very meticulously. And both of these are 6-week self-paced courses that people can try out for free. They just have to sign up on my website and they can try it out for free. And, you know, if they like it, they could work with me. And at this point of time, it's hard to say what all they can get from working with me because I'm like, you know, we're constantly evolving and doing new things. So, yeah.
And are these courses one-on-one? Do they start at a particular date or time, or is that just a rolling
No,
basis?
it's a rolling basis. It's just a bunch of videos and exercises that you get access to.
You mentioned a website. What would be the address, and is that the best place to reach you?
Yeah, it's marriagebrokerauntie.com. It's auntie with IE, not Y.
So guys, if If you also, you can find Manage Broker Auntie on Instagram as well. Is that also a decent place to reach out to you?
Yeah, for sure.
Okay.
Yeah.
So you can find them on Manage Broker Auntie on Instagram as well. The comment which is pinned, you can see the handle there. And if you're going to be watching this later as an IGTV video, Priyanka and Manage Broker Auntie will be tagged there as well. So definitely do reach out to her. Priyanka, thank you for the conversation. Very open, very sort of, it gave me also things to think about.
Awesome.
But really interesting space to be in. And I wish you and Manage Broker Auntie the best. Thank you for joining
Thank
and for
you.
sharing your thoughts.
Yeah. Thank you so much for having me. It was an absolute pleasure to talk to you.
Likewise.
A good break from I guess just talking about how I built my business and things like that. It was nice to talk about the dynamics of relationships. So yeah, thank you so much for the conversation.
Absolutely. And guys, stay safe. Last message for you. Oh, by the way, Priyanka, I have noticed, is that a Liverpool poster behind you?
Yeah,
I'm very happy about that.
I don't care
Very
about the
happy
club,
about
but
that.
it's my husband's.
No, you need to say, well, your husband deserves full kudos for that. But guys, just the last thing, I know that the number of new cases of COVID are going down, but please maintain your precautions. We did the same thing the last time around. Things started getting better. We just stepped out without taking precautions. Let's not repeat it for the sake of all Indians. So stay safe, double mask, try and get vaccinated as quickly as possible. And have a great weekend. Thanks, guys.
Yeah, thank you. Bye.
Bye-bye.